Good evening, everyone. It's time to begin our service. We'll begin our service in just a moment by reading from Matthew chapter 22, verses 34 through 40. We're glad you're here. We invite you back any chance you have the opportunity to be in our area. Brother Jeff Crockett will be leading our singing tonight, and after a singing of a couple, two or three songs, Brother Barry Cahoon will lead us in prayer. But when the Pharisees heard that he had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together. Then one of them, a lawyer, asked him a question, testing him, saying, "Teacher, which is the great commandment in the law?" And Jesus said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. And this is the first and great commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets."
Good evening. If you're using a book, first song will be 200. Number 200. We'll have two songs tonight before we have our prayer. Number 200. First and third verse.
Hallelujah, praise Jehovah, from the heavens praise His name. Praise Jehovah in the highest, all His angels praise proclaim. All His hosts together praise Him, sun and moon and stars on high. Praise Him, O ye heaven of heaven, and ye clouds above the sky. Let them praise His name, Jehovah, for His name alone is high. And His glory is exalted, and His glory is exalted, and His glory is exalted far above the earth and sky. All ye fruitful trees and cedars, all ye hills and mountains high, creeping things and beasts and distress. Oh, my
Let us pray. Most gracious and ever-loving Heavenly Father, truly, Heavenly Father, our prayer is that you would hear us this evening. Heavenly Father, we know this is only possible because of thy Son. Only in him, Heavenly Father, can we live and move and have our being. Heavenly Father, help us to each examine our own lives, Heavenly Father, so that we always remember that without Christ, we're lost. Without Christ, we're without hope. Heavenly Father, help us to always keep that in perspective, that it was you who sacrificed for us, your only Son. Heavenly Father, in light of this, help us to each and every day strive to be like Jesus, to obey thee, Heavenly Father, as you have told us so many times over and over in the Word. Heavenly Father, help us to read and study, and help Heavenly Father the Word to become part of who we are. Help us to teach others, Heavenly Father, in word and in deed. Heavenly Father, we ask that you would be with all the teachers who strive to teach those the Word. And Heavenly Father, we'd ask that you would be with Brother Edward tonight, and always, Heavenly Father, be with Justin and the work that they do here, and help us all, Heavenly Father, to work toward that common goal of saving souls. There are many people, Heavenly Father, out there who are sin sick. Not that we all, Heavenly Father, aren't stained by the sins of this world and of our own actions, Heavenly Father, but there are those out there without hope. And we need to do our best, Heavenly Father, to tell them of Jesus. Heavenly Father, there are many things that this world needs so much for you to help them with. Heavenly Father, it can start as high as the governments over the lands across this globe, and it can fall down, Heavenly Father, even to the daily walks that each of us have at work and with those that are around us. Heavenly Father, we pray for our leaders. We pray for those in authority anywhere, Heavenly Father, that they don't abuse and misuse their authority. They would look to Thee, who is the teacher of all things, Heavenly Father, which are good and righteous. Heavenly Father, there are many of whom we love that are sick and afflicted, Heavenly Father of the flesh. Heavenly Father, they're striving against pain and illness, Heavenly Father. We'd ask that you would comfort them and continue to watch over them and the hands that take care of them and restore their health, Heavenly Father, if it be thy will. Heavenly Father, each and every one of us walks the walk of this earth as Christ did, and we all know the inevitability, Heavenly Father, of this life. Heavenly Father, our life is but a vapor, and pretty soon, Heavenly Father, we will face thee. Help us to walk, Heavenly Father, in light of that day. The world, Heavenly Father, steals our attention so often. We get distracted with the things of which we desire or we want. Even the things, Heavenly Father, that we need tend to creep into our lives so much that we put Thee aside and Thy will. Heavenly Father, help us to work to be like Christ, and to put you always first, even unto death. Be with us, Heavenly Father, as we continue our worship unto thee. Heavenly Father, we always pray that we do this in spirit and in truth. And Heavenly Father, help us to walk each and every day in the spirit and in truth. These things, Heavenly Father, we ask only because of Jesus, your Son and our Savior. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
If you'd like to mark it, our song of invitation will be 517. Number 517. And before Brother Eber's lesson, number 66. Sing the first and third verse of this one.
Beautiful roads so wide, beautiful land of light, beautiful home so bright, where the shall come no night, beautiful crown where the shining and bright, oh, that yonder in mansions that gather us there.
Take a study guide from the gentlemen as they come down the aisle. Yeah, here it comes. Barry will be in just a moment. Get a study guide from him and take some notes on this evening's lesson. But take your Bible above all in hand and be ready to turn to passages that we allude to and read and study and search the Scriptures for yourself. We're happy that you're here tonight, especially is that the case if you should be visiting with us. We're honored, and we hope that you will come and be with us again very, very soon. Think what you will of him. Some love him, some hate him. But Nick Saban is probably one of the most successful football coaches that's ever been. As you think about the record that he has established at the University of Alabama and prior to that at LSU, he always seems to have the ability to produce a winning team, except maybe in the NFL. But Saban's life has been sort of interest to me, his background, and I've done a little research on it and so on. But his University of Alabama teams have won 4 national championships. And they have been in the last 2 collegiate championship games, splitting those games with Clemson University, as most football fans know. Each team won a championship the past 2 years. As you think about Saban, he's obviously very, very successful. He believes in teamwork. He believes in discipline, accountability, and acting responsibly. There have been some good athletes who have started out with him that did not end up with him because he was very demanding and so on. But he seems to win on a regular basis. His teams do. And I was watching a particular game this past season where Kirk Herbstreit was asked by the other announcer in the booth, "Why do you think Saban is so successful?" Of course, there was the obvious, the knowledge of the game and all of that, and the quality athletes that he's been able to recruit. But he said, "I think that there is something about him that really stands out, and that is that he has a unique ability to get those who play for him to buy into the coach's philosophy." And you go back to that team orientation, hard work, discipline, dedication, all of those things. He places the bar pretty high for himself and for all of his players. And he wants them to aspire to be good, even great. Some coaches can sell that philosophy that they have. Others maybe have difficulty getting it across. But when I heard that statement, I thought, that is a really good idea. Tonight, we're going to be talking about buying into the coach's philosophy. And this sermon is not about Nick Saban. It's not even really about football. But we're going to take some things about football and apply them to all of us as Christians. Our coach is Jesus the Christ. He is the coach. If you've ever played athletics of any type, someone who has taught you and been your mentor and your coach, you always appreciate them unless they have just been really terrible and hateful and ugly to you. And you will probably use the title coach when you meet them as long as you live or as long as they live. They will always be coach to you. A coach is one who teaches a particular discipline or sport or whatever. He tries to coach us. He encourages us. But he's also an instructor, a teacher, first and foremost. Jesus is our master teacher. And we should aspire to buy into his philosophy, not our own, not the world's. One of the biggest problems with members of the Lord's church, all of us in general, is really being dedicated to doing what the coach tells us to do instead of thinking about what we want to do or what somebody else wants us to do. Very early on in the ministry of our Lord, he came to that wedding feast in Cana of Galilee in John 2. And there were those there who began to despair because there was not wine for the celebration. You'll remember Jesus' mother said, "Whatsoever he says unto you, do it." Now I think we need to pull that out and remember that as followers of Jesus Christ. Our desire should be to do whatever he says unto us. And we all are familiar with Matthew 17:5, that statement where God said, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. Hear you him." Take heed to what my Son says from here on. He's going to be my spokesman. When there were those, evidently many people, who turned and walked no more with Jesus because of his hard sayings in John chapter 6. He turned to the apostles and said, "Would you also go away?" And Peter said, "Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life." So it's only to Christ that we need to look in order to find out the will of God and to know what our Heavenly Father expects of us. We need to listen to Jesus. He is our coach. He is our mentor. He is the one, according to Hebrews 1, 1 and 2, through whom God now speaks to his children. He will teach us the truth. He is the master teacher. So will you buy into the coach's philosophy and put into practice in your life what he teaches you? This coach that we're talking about tonight knows about the game of life. He knows even about eternal life. So we need to pay attention to it. Saban evidently knows the game of football. Jesus Christ knows about the game of life. He came to this low ground of sin and sorrow and lived upon this earth. He came into the world to be loved by many but hated by multitudes. We know that he came unto his own and his own received him not. John 1 verse 11. And we read of many passages such as we read in our Bible reading tonight. When the Pharisees saw that the Sadducees had been silenced by our Lord, they wanted to try their hand at showing him up, embarrassing and humiliating him by the questions that they asked. We read this morning about when the Herodians got involved in that particular tactic as well. And so there were people who sought to ensnare him, but he never once stumbled. He came with a purpose in life. And that purpose is borne out in numerous passages. In Philippians 2, verses 5 through 8, we learn of his coming for the purpose clearly of doing the will of God, even if that meant going to the cross and dying for the sins of men. As he prayed in the garden, he said, "Not my will, but thine be done." And he was persistent in that thought, praying that same prayer three times. "If it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt. Thy will be done." Is that the way we pray? It certainly ought to be. But furthermore, is that the way we live? Surely it should be. Jesus came to do the will of his Father, and he would not be sidetracked from that. Jesus is our coach, and we need to buy into his philosophy. In spite of all the opposition that he encountered, he accomplished his purpose. I went back and looked at the book of Hebrews. In Hebrews chapter 2, I believe it's verse 10, he is identified as the captain of our salvation. In chapter 5, verses 8 and 9, he is described as the author of eternal salvation to all who obey him. And then a little bit later in chapter 12, verse 2, he is identified as the author and finisher of our faith. Those three passages should stand out in our minds. They remind us of the fact that he is the one that we are to follow, to whom we are to listen. And you'll remember in Matthew 16, he said, "He that loses his life for my sake shall find it." He shows us that we win by losing. Now that is completely contrary to the coaching philosophy of a lot of coaches today, isn't it? There used to be a man who said, you know, "It's not whether you win or lose, it's how you play the game." And others said, "Winning is not everything." There are some coaches today who tell their athletes, "Winning is everything." That's what it's all about. If you don't win, then you lose. Jesus said, there is a sense in which you can win only by losing. What is a man profited if he should gain the whole world and lose his soul? But if you lose your life for my sake, he said, you will have won. So Jesus teaches us about the game of life and how to, quote, play it. A second thing that I want us to notice is that this coach, and I would not refer to him necessarily as Coach Jesus, certainly not in a derogatory way, because he's so much more than a mere coach. But this coach, if we could call him that, certainly knows something about tackling temptation. Many of you know that Scotty Yeaman played football and coached football for a good while. And he told me not long after we moved here, as we were talking one day, and I've never forgotten that. He said, if my team lost a game on Monday when we came back in, we went back to blocking and tackling. He said, you usually lose games because you do not block and tackle well. And he said, we would just work on that relentlessly because it's so important. Jesus teaches a lot about tackling temptation. You remember he took the devil on the devil's home field and won. Matthew chapter 4, you've read it many times. Many of you are aware of the fact that Satan came and tempted our Lord when Jesus was hungry and at his weakest, and yet he overcame. Not by physical bread and meat, but by the bread of life, the word of the Lord. We remember that three times he turned temptation aside by saying, it is written. It is written. It is written. Three times in Matthew 4. Jesus used the word of God to defeat the devil. As you read in James 1, we're not tempted by God. He tempts no man. James 1, verses 13 and 14. So, Jesus did not blame his heavenly Father. But he knew that it was a part of the will of God for him to face temptation, because how else would he be able to be our succorer, our helper, even our Savior, our high priest, unless he experienced what those that he came to save would experience in their lives. And he told the apostles without any qualification or reservation, you don't know all that you're going to face because of me. You're going to be tempted in ways that you've never imagined. But you will be able to overcome as I have overcome. By turning to God, seeking to do His will in all things, and realizing that though you may lose your life for my sake, you will find it. You will save your soul by losing your life if you do it in my service. Jesus tackled temptation by using the word. Again, it is written, he reminded Satan. In James 4, James tells us to draw near to God. But he tells us before that, resist the devil and he will flee from you. Draw near or nigh to God and he will draw near to you. Though Jesus was hungry when he was tempted, he overcame by using the bread of life, the word of God. The meat and milk of the Word, I suppose you could say, to tackle temptation. Jesus teaches us something also about blocking false doctrine. Jesus used the Word again to block false doctrines. In Matthew 15, it was concerning the traditions of men and worship. And he said that those people who worship according to the doctrines and commandments of men, and he quoted from the book of Isaiah, he said, their heart is far from me. They're not doing the will of God. And so he used the Old Testament scriptures to refute that. Did the same thing in Matthew 19 in reference to marriage, divorce, and remarriage. He referred to the Genesis account and said, I know what is going on now, and I know that Moses permitted you to put away your wives and so on, But from the beginning it was not so. And he goes on to refer to what had been stated by Moses in recording the things that transpired at the beginning of time. That God made man and made a woman, brought them together. They became one flesh, and what God had joined together, no man was to put asunder. Notice how he uses the scripture to block the false doctrines of some of the Jewish leaders in that day. There were two primary schools of thought, and Jesus refuted both of them by simply saying, let's get back to the original plan. Here is what God said in the very beginning, and Jesus is affirming in so many words, his will hasn't changed. His will has not been altered, changed since that time. Oh, Moses, because of the hardness of your heart, allowed you to do some things. But here is the will of God that was stated at the very beginning of time. If you were watching the Super Bowl a few days ago, you may or may not have noticed how important blocking is. I told someone after I watched the last half of the game, that game probably turned on one play. That was when Atlanta had the ball and they were within field goal range, and the running back failed to pick up a pass rusher. He whipped. It looked like he even saw him. And the guy ran right by him, tackled the Atlanta quarterback for a loss, put them out of field goal range. That field goal would probably have won the Super Bowl for him. But because of a missed block, think of all the souls that are going to be saved because we often do not use God's word to block false doctrine, to refute it. We must be kind, loving, speak the word in truth, but speak it in love. But we must speak the truth. We must tell people, here is what's wrong with that doctrine. And look at God's word and say, here's why it's wrong. Not because I think it is or somebody else thinks it is, but because God says that it is. You know, you can take God's word and block false doctrine. You look at Paul's statement in 2 Timothy 4, verses 1 through 4, when he gave that charge to Timothy to preach the word. Have you noticed what that's rooted in? He's talking about a time when people are not going to hold to the doctrine of Christ anymore. They're going to be giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of men. And he talks about the fact that they will turn away their ears from the truth and not be content with what God has spoken. He said, Timothy, though that may occur, your responsibility is to still preach the word and to be instant in season, out of season. Notice, to reprove, rebuke, and exhort. We usually think of reproving and rebuking as being directed toward moral sin. They are. But they also involve the rebuking and reproving of doctrinal sin. The teaching of and the following of false doctrines. And people must be exhorted to leave immoral practices. They must be exhorted to leave doctrinal practices that are not right as well. So Jesus teaches us to block false doctrine. The next place, I want you to know that this coach, Jesus the Christ, knows how to defeat the opposition. A really successful coach will study the opposing team, find out that team's weaknesses, and then attack. If, for example, the defensive backfield on a football team is pretty weak and anemic and not able to defend the pass, that's probably where they will be attacked. If they have a defensive line that doesn't tackle very well, doesn't get off blocks very well, then they will run the ball. If they have a tendency to put a lot of people up at the line of scrimmage, they'll probably throw it. If they have a tendency to put seven or eight smaller defenders, on the field, they'll probably run it, especially if they have a big, bruising running back and a lot of hefty linemen who can really run and block. They attack the weaknesses of the opposition. Well, Jesus knows the opposition, the opposing team, really well. He knows that the devil is our adversary. Peter describes him in that way in 1 Peter 5:8. Tells us to be sober and be vigilant. Why? Because your adversary, the devil, walks about as a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. Now, we've already seen that Jesus met and defeated the devil one-on-one. But his body, the church, his army, if you please, we're soldiers of Christ, are on the field of battle every day. And we need to remember how important it is to present a united front, to keep the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace, as Paul talks about in Ephesians 4, 1 through 3. We need to understand the importance of being well armed and equipped, taking the armor of the Lord, as described in Ephesians 6, verses 10 through 18. We need to understand the importance of being actively involved, not becoming indifferent, not going AWOL, and being away from our post of duty. We're reminded that the team that is coached by the Lord is going to win finally and ultimately. But we are now upon the battlefield. The enemies of God's people will be vanquished forever to languish in the fires of the lake that burns with fire and brimstone. Jesus talked about that in Matthew 25, verse 41. And there are several depictions of it in the book of Revelation. In our young adult class downstairs, we're presently studying what the Bible has to say about this terrible place called hell. A lot of people don't want to talk about it anymore. Someone told me not long ago, I don't know how long it's been since I heard a sermon on hell. I said, you should have been at Carthage a few weeks ago. They said, why? I said, because we took a look into the abyss. We looked through a glass bridge into that great abyss that's described in the Bible. We need to appreciate that. That was prepared for the devil and his angels. His angels are messengers. They're followers of Satan. And that term angel comes from a word that can be a reference to human messengers or messengers of a spiritual nature in the spirit world. Jesus teaches us that we can overcome not only temptation, but all adversaries and adversities. We're more than conquerors through Him who loved us and died for us, as Romans 8, verse 37 tells us. So it's so important to be in Christ. This coach also knows both offense and defense. Nick Saban is recognized as a defensive guru. He knows defensive football. He knows how it should be played. And some of his Alabama teams have been described as the best defensive football teams that have ever gotten on the field. They do play really well, and they come up, it seems, with big play after big play. But Saban needs a coordinator for the offensive side. He's probably got a defensive coordinator too. But Lane Kiffin was hired as an offensive coordinator. He's not going to be there next year. But when you look at some of the coaches, they're stronger on one side than they are the other. And so they try to make a good hire. The coach at Vanderbilt has coached defensively for a long time, and so he just finally gave up and said, you know, our defense not playing, I'm going to take the defense over myself. And they played much better on defense. Jesus knows both offense and defense. Look at what he tells us. Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. That's going on the offensive. You take the message to the world. Go teach all nations. Those statements you know are found in Mark 16:15 and Matthew 28:19. But notice, that's going on the offense. And those weapons that we talked about a little while ago from Ephesians 6, they are defensive weapons, you know, like the breastplate, the shield, the sword of the Spirit, is both offensive and defensive in nature. You can use the Word of God to go on the offensive, penetrate the hearts of people, lay bare the lives of an individual, causing that individual to want to turn from the life of sin and live a life of righteousness. And you can block the blows of false doctrine with the sword of the Spirit. You can utilize it either offensively or defensively. When Jesus said, you are the salt of the earth and you're the light of the world, what's he telling us? You can make a big difference by simply being a good example. By living according to the precepts that he was teaching in Matthew 5, 6, and 7. The Sermon on the Mount. So, those are offensive schemes. Sometimes people say, well, I can't go into anybody's house and sit down with them and teach them the gospel. Well, you probably underestimate your ability when you say that. And you certainly need to try to prepare yourself to be able to answer people who might ask you a question. But you also could prepare yourself to go on the offensive and teach people the truth of God. But even if you don't have the ability to do that, you can live a godly life before other people. And that makes so much difference in our world. But notice how he says, beware of false prophets. Matthew 7:15. You know, they're like wolves in sheep's clothing. And you need to know them by their fruits. You need to be able to defend yourself against them. And probably the classic passage is when Paul said, I am set for the defense of the gospel. In Philippians chapter 1. Jude adds to that, that we need to be able to contend earnestly for the faith that was once delivered in Jude verse 3. So you have both offensive and defensive schemes, if you want to call them that. Just like football teams have offensive and defensive schemes. Jesus says, go on the offense, but always be ready to play defense. You have to be ready. You need to try the spirits. 1 John 4:1, to see whether they are of God. Take a stand for that which is right. Jesus is a coach too in the sense that he has authority. How much authority? All authority. If you don't think Nick Saban has authority, ask Lane Kiffin. I saw him chew Kiffin out on the sideline once because he didn't call a play or he didn't do something. He was doing something that was totally away from the philosophy of Saban. And he let him know about it. He called him out, as the saying goes. He is the coach. Jesus is our coach. We're to honor his authority. And if we do something that is not in keeping with his teachings, guess who is wrong? It's not our Lord. Because he always tells us the truth. If you question the authority of Jesus about a matter, as many of the Pharisees, Sadducees, Herodians, and others did, then you need to go and check his word and see what he says about it. He will tell us the wise thing and the right thing. Jesus taught as one with authority. Matthew 7, 28 and 29 remind us. People were amazed by how he just demonstrated authority in the manner in which he taught, not like the scribes and Pharisees. And then, too, he said, if any man doesn't receive my word, he's going to be judged by that very word. He who rejects me and what I have said is going to have one that judges him. The word that I have spoken, the same shall judge him in the last day. John 12, verse 48. If you still question his authority, just wait till judgment day. Matthew 7 tells us that many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have I not done all of these many wonderful works in thy name? But I will say, depart from me. I never knew you. Depart from me. Think of how tragic that would be. Jesus teaches us so many things. He teaches us how to play the game of life. He teaches us to put the team first. He set an example for us, 1 Peter 2:21, that we should walk in his steps. He said, here's how you do it. A coach sometimes will show a player how to do something. I was a football coach at Jackson County many years ago. Not a very big fella. He was new on the scene there in Gainesboro. And there was a boy who played ball for him. His name was Charles, but everybody called him Rough House. And he loved to tackle somebody. And one day that new coach said to somebody, to one of these players, let me show you how you do that. And he told old Rough House to line down. This boy, coach didn't have a single pad on or anything. And you said, well, Roughhouse took it easy on him. No, he didn't. He knocked that coach down and just run him into the ground. Roughhouse showed him how to tackle. The coach didn't. The coach was tackled on that particular play. And I've heard that story several times over the years. But Jesus has walked here. He's walked among men. He showed us how we're to conduct ourselves and how we are to do the will of God. He tells us to put team first. Matthew 6:33, that's what he's saying. Seek you first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Philippians 2 shows us that there is no I in team. You hear that slogan a lot? The word team does not have an I in it. We are a team. That's what he's telling us. And he says that the one who would be greatest in my kingdom is going to be the servant of all. He puts others first. He's concerned about his teammates. He leaves it all on the field. even if it means losing his life. He'll gain heaven if he's willing to give up his life, lose his life for my sake. Are you on the Lord's team? You need to be. You need to be baptized into Christ to become a member of his body, the church. That'll put you on his team. And then serve him faithfully. Follow his teachings and instructions. Buy into his philosophy. Go the second mile. Do those things that may seem small and insignificant to the world, but in the eyes of God, they're great. If you're subject to the invitation, either as one who has never obeyed or as one who has but has become unfaithful, we hope that you'll respond in obedience to the will of the Lord as we stand and as we sing.
Oh, do not let the word depart and close our eyes against the light. For sinner, pardon not thy heart. Be saved, Lord, tonight. Oh, why not tonight? Oh, why not tonight? This is the time, oh then be wise, be saved, oh, tonight. Oh, why not tonight? Oh, why not tonight? Well,
opportunity this morning to partake of it. You want to turn to page 203. We'll sing the first and the fifth stanzas of this. And while we're singing this, if you'll come down to this front pew to the right, you'll be waited on.
Man of sorrows, what a name for the Son of God who came, ruined sinners to reclaim. Alleluia, what a Savior. When he comes as glorious King, all his ransomed home to bring, then anew this song we'll sing. Alleluia, what a Savior.
Be seated. Shall we pray? Our almighty Heavenly Father, we humbly bow our heads to you as we approach your throne of grace this evening. Father, we are so thankful for all your blessings that you bestow upon us. Lord, we are thankful for your grace and your mercy
in your scheme of redemption that has allowed us to have the hope of heaven because of the willingness of your Son to come to this earth to fight off the temptations of this world and to go to the cross and die for us, Lord, and to shed his blood and to be buried and to be resurrected again. Father, at this time, we pray that you be with those who partake of this bread which represents that body. May they do so in a manner that is well-pleasing in your sight. In Christ's name, amen. Again, shall we pray? Likewise, Heavenly Father, again we bow our heads to you, honoring you as the true and living God. Father, we are thankful for Jesus. We are thankful for him being the spotted, unblemished lamb for us to sacrifice himself and to shed that precious blood for us that gives us the redemption of our sins and hope of heaven. Father, be with those who partake of this cup. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Separate and apart from the Lord's Supper, we also have the opportunity to give of our means on the first day of the week. Shall we pray? Glorious Heavenly Father, again, we are thankful for everything that you do for us. We are thankful for our spiritual blessings and our physical blessings. Father, we are thankful for the opportunity that we have to live in this country, Lord, to be able to prosper in it, Lord. Father, we are thankful for the abilities we have and the different abilities that we have to earn a portion of this world's goods. Father, we pray that those who give back of those goods at this time do so with a loving and cheerful heart. In Christ's name, amen.
Closing hymn will be 850. And if you're using your book to find that song, and Jeff will lead us in it in just a moment. Then Brother Derek Triplett will be leading us in our closing prayer. We appreciate the presence of each one of you tonight. We have an additional note or two that we did not have earlier. On the happy birthday list, we need to remember Haven Brown, February 15th. And are the children better, Josh? They're on their way back. All right. They were both sick this morning. I did not know that until after services. And so let's keep them in our prayers. And Carolyn Sales, who is Lola King's sister, has a blood clot in her arm. And she had surgery back surgery last fall. And so let's remember her as well. Sister Hattie Branham remains in the hospital at Gallatin. I have not heard. Is Dennis back there tonight? Okay. Dennis, let me know if you have heard anything from her surgical plans. Okay. They do not know whether she will have the surgery tomorrow or not, but Miss Hattie is pretty ill, and let's keep her in our prayers. Miss Dixon is still not feeling well, and we would appreciate your prayers on her behalf. Glad Francis is able to be with us tonight. And remember, good to have Brother Joe Hensley back with us as well. Caleb Harville is still not feeling well. And let's remember him in our prayers. Graduating seniors, if you're interested in a scholarship from the Run for Don program, you need to pick up a copy of that application out in the foyer, if you would, please. And remember that Darlene may need some help this week, February 15th and 16th. I believe that'll be Wednesday and Thursday. She works over at the pavilion and is the one that does the payroll and will be needing to have some time to do that. And she's been very attentive and staying with her mom and caring for her. And let's help out if we can. And you need to tell Dennis if you can do that, please. I believe that's all the announcements that I have. Are there any other announcements that need to be made? Joe. All right, Joan Cherry, which hospital? Murfreesboro. Let's remember Joan in our prayers as well. Any others? Thank you so much for being here. Let's stand for the closing song and prayer and plan to be back Wednesday night for the 7 o'clock service.
Heavenly Father, we are so grateful that we've had this opportunity to come together this evening, study a portion of Thy Word, and sing songs of praise to Thee. Heavenly Father, we ask a healing hand upon those that have been mentioned tonight, those that are recovering. Be with those that are going through treatments this week, Heavenly Father, if it be Thy will, they be restored to a better state of health. Heavenly Father, we have those that our members here that weren't able to attend tonight for various reasons. We pray that you watch over them. Watch over all of us as we leave this place tonight. Please forgive us now of our sins and make sure that we are able to attend this next Wednesday night. These things we ask in Thy Son's most holy name. Amen.